Isn't that a nice piece?
Michael, that was magnificent. That's one of my very favorites. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Welcome, St. Andrew's United Church. My name is Reverend Katherine Selby, and it is my honor to serve as the minister here. And on behalf of all of us, we would like you to know, no matter who you are, no matter where you come from, no matter what you believe or what you doubt, you are welcome in this place. And we are so glad that you are here tuning in online. And now let us pass the peace, the wholeness, the shalom of Christ to one another. Peace be with you. So it was brought to my attention this week by your chair, John Webster, that the orders of service are too long to print out at home, but we really want to sing and follow along with the lyrics. It's so nice to have an easily fixable problem. So what we're going to do from here on out is Nayla will also send a PDF with just the hymns and just the lyrics. So if you want to print them off, or if you just want to follow along on a device, those will be available every single week. And we may, if we can figure out the technology and get with it, we may provide the lyrics on the screen. We will see. So thank you so much for participating. And Michael, another one of my favorites, hymn number 220, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, verses 1 and 4. Let us pray. The Spirit is a force of love, wild and creative. She tears down the walls of our hearts and builds up courage within. The Spirit is a practice of freedom. She is daring and audacious. She nurtures gentle strength, that our hope may thrive and justice be our aim. Come, Spirit of Christ, and rise among us. Let us pray. Holy One, our source of life and love, build up our faith. May we dare to believe that things can be done differently. May we be willing to take necessary risks for others. May we persevere through our mistakes and missteps. With joy as our companion and wisdom as our guide, we place our trust in you. Amen. Hymn number 296, This is God's Wondrous World, verses 1 and 3.
This is God's
Thank you, Michael. And now we have children's time led by our worship chair, Maria Bercy. Welcome, Maria.
Good morning, everyone. How are you guys? So we're still talking about the Ten Commandments, and we're going to read a story this morning. I want you to try to guess which one we're talking about while you listen. This is The Bear, the Piano, the Dog, and the Fiddle by David Litchfield. He's a British writer, and he's also the illustrator for this book. So he did the words and the pictures, okay? Pam, do you want to come over and read too? Oh, no, he does not want to come. Okay. Hector and Hugo were best friends. Hector was a fiddle player, and Hugo was one of his biggest fans. Over the years, they had good times, bad times, and even some crazy times. But now times weren't so great. "What are we going to do, Hugo?" Hector said as they walked home. "My act is yesterday's news. Who would want to listen to an old fiddler like me when they can watch a world-famous piano-playing bear?" Hugo woofed to say that he would, but Hector just sighed. "I'm too old for this game, boy," he said. "I guess I'll never get to play in a big concert hall like I dreamed." And with that, Hector packed away his fiddle forever. Now that Hector didn't go out to play music, he spent most of his time watching TV, listening to audiobooks, sleeping, and sleeping some more. Hector and Hugo's neighborhood was noisy, so Hector kept the windows open while he slept. But one night, he forgot. In the early hours of the morning, a strange noise woke him up. Hector crept out of bed, tiptoed down the hallway, and pushed open the door to the roof. Hugo was playing Hector's fiddle, and the music Hugo was making was toe-tappingly, finger-clickingly, whistle-blowingly awesome. Hector's tummy hurt a bit when he saw everyone in the neighborhood nodding along, but then he saw something else, how much his friend loved to play. The next morning, Hector taught Hugo all the tricks of the trade he'd learned over the years. Before long, a crowd had gathered. News of the incredible fiddle-playing dog spread, and one day, a very famous bear came to watch. Bear told Hugo that he was starting a band of musical animals. He invited him to come on tour and play his fiddle for hundreds of thousands of people. As Hugo looked up at Hector, his tail wagging, Hector's tummy started to hurt again. He was jealous. "I guess you should go," he said, trying to smile. "It's the opportunity of a lifetime." Hugo's tail wagged even more as he packed to go away with Bear's big band, making sure the fiddle was safely stowed. But Hector began to have second thoughts. "Don't go and join that silly group, Hugo," he said. "We don't need them." Hugo put his head on Hector's knee, but Hector pushed him away. "Fine," said Hector. "I'm sure you'll be back with your tail between your legs. You're not even that good." Hugo picked up his suitcase and left. Suddenly, Hector felt awful. "Wait, Hugo," he cried. "I'm so..." But it was too late. With Bear's big band, Hugo toured the world, playing spectacular shows to sold-out crowds of adoring fans. Hugo was the star of the show. With Bear on the piano, Big G on drums, Clint the Wolfman, Jones grooving on the double bass, millions of people watched them all over the world on their televisions and computer screens. Millions of people, including Hector, as he watched, he missed making music. He missed playing his fiddle. Most of all, he missed his friend. One day, Hector saw some posters announcing that Bear's band was playing in the big concert hall in his city. Hector wanted to go, but then he remembered the horrible thing he had said. What if Hugo didn't want him there? Hector bought a ticket anyway and found a spot up front right by the stage. Then the band started playing. Hector couldn't believe how mind-blowingly, toe-tappingly, finger-clickingly awesome the music was. "Hugo," he shouted, "it's me, Hector, you're brilliant. I'm so proud of you." But Hugo just whispered something to Bear, who whispered something to a security guard, then they continued to play. A few minutes later, Hector felt two big paws grab him. "What's going on?" he asked nervously. The security guards picked up Hector and took him into a dark corridor. "It's okay," Hector said, "I was going to leave anyway. Let me go." But the guards just kept walking with Hector squished between them until suddenly they stopped, and Hector realized where he was. Ladies and gentlemen, boomed a voice, I'm pleased to announce that tonight Bear's Big Band will be joined by a very special guest. Please give a warm welcome to Hector. I'm told that our star Hugo wouldn't be here without him. As the crowd cheered, Hugo passed Hector his old fiddle. He'd kept it safe all this time. He woofed and wagged his tail. And as Hector took his fiddle, he realized, though he and Hugo may have had some good times, some bad times, and even some times apart, they would always still be friends. Because good friendship, just like good music, lasts a lifetime. The end. Okay, so if you guessed commandment number 10, do not covet, you would be correct. Now, that one comes from Exodus 20:17, which the New King James Version is, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Now, what does that mean? The International Children's Version says, you must not want to take anything that belongs to your neighbor. Now, this is so hard. So hard. I have a few thoughts. Like Hector, we feel jealousy in our body, don't we? So this is like what Reverend Katherine has been talking about the last couple of weeks in her body, her sermon series on the body. Sometimes when you get overrun by jealousy, if you get a really strange feeling, like Hector got it in his tummy, didn't he? He felt really sick in his stomach. For me, sometimes I get it, my head feels like my brain's on fire when I get really jealous. So our bodies are trying to tell us that we feel jealous. And I think one of the reasons that God doesn't want us to feel jealous of what other people have is because it can get in the way of love, right? It can get in the way of friendships. We saw this with Hector and Hugo. They reunited in the end, but there was a while there where they were separated because of the jealousy. And unfortunately, there's really no solution for jealousy. You just have to feel grateful for what you have. You count your blessings. You may not play the fiddle as well as Hugo, but you still can play, and you have your friendship. And if you concentrate on those things, sometimes the jealousy can fade away. Now, everybody finds this hard. If they tell you they don't, they're lying to you, which is a different commandment. So basically, if you find yourself feeling jealous, it just means you're human, okay? So that is all for this week. Try to remember to count your blessings. Let's say a short prayer together, okay? Let's put our hands on our hearts. Dear God, sometimes it feels like you have asked us to do the impossible and not be jealous of others. In those moments when jealousy floods our bodies, please help us to remember to be grateful for all we have. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Maria. That was fantastic. And now let us pray the prayer that Christ, our elder brother, taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Next, we have our scripture reading, and this will be read to us by Lisa Belanger. Welcome, Lisa.
Hello. Good to see everyone. So the first reading is Philippians 2:1-13. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, if you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. The next one is Matthew 21, 23 to 32. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or of human origin?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered, but later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir,' but he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him."
Thank you, Lisa. And now we have the Ministry of Music by Jeannie Gilchrist. "Your Love Still Amazes Me."
Your love is still a mystery. Each
Thank you, Jeannie. That was beautiful. And I love all the butterflies. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, wild and free, we thank you so much for this sacred time where we can all gather. I ask God that you would soften our hearts, that you would open our ears, that you would allow us to feel all of the senses in our body so that we may know you more, so that we may know ourselves more, so that we may know one another more. I thank you, God, for your love that is stronger than any other force in this universe, that your love that can overcome everything. And I ask, God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts, all of our inner selves, be pleasing in your sight. For you are St. Andrew's strength, and you are St. Andrew's redeemer. Amen. Pardon me. I have a cough. Hold on. Excuse me. Okay, so we are in the middle of your fully human minister. We are in the middle of a sermon series called Beloved Body, Beloved Soul. And even the act of breaking up the body and soul is very dualistic, thanks to Plato. Our Hebrew understanding, Jesus's understanding of his own body and soul would have been that they were all one thing, that he was connected. So we're paying special attention to our bodies to try to bring our bodies back into the equation and stop judging our bodies and seeing our bodies with their resentment and jealousy and weariness as a problem to overcome. And instead looking at our bodies as the source of how the spirit speaks to us with deep wisdom. As we've talked about, but I just want to ground it in this, our story of creation is a story of a God who created us in God's own image so that we bear the image of the divine. We have the psalmist saying, I am fearfully and wonderfully made, body and soul. And then we have this story of this Garden of Eden, meaning a garden of pleasure, full of nature and animals that God places humanity in to invite us into God's pleasure. So that joy and pleasure are the rhythms of how we are meant to live, how we were created to live. And we can tell when we're in places or situations that we're not flourishing, that there's something off. So God uses our bodies, God gives us these bodies with senses, not as something to judge, but as something to give us GPSs and clues as to what's going on. So today we're talking about kenosis. I want you to say this word out loud, kenosis. Congratulations, Greek scholars, kenosis. So this word is attached to the Philippians chapter 2 passage that Lisa read today. And this word kenosis is the word used to describe Jesus, that Jesus who had the nature of God, because Jesus was God, emptied himself out and poured himself out on behalf of humanity. And we are called not to hold on to our power, not to hold on to our privilege, not to hold on to any benefits that we may have, but to also pour these out on behalf of one another. And when I was younger, I was not a fan of becoming a Christian because it felt like Jesus was very like almost spineless. Like, to follow Jesus, you have to give everything away and you have to like be beholden to people, and you know, you can't have anything for yourself. And this kenosis thing is sometimes used in that, where it is a critique of a very selfish culture that puts ourselves at the center. So the Christian calling that I was taught is to be selfless, to give yourself away. So we are going to learn more and explore more today about how our bodies, with our five senses that God gives us, can give us clues as to where we should pour out our life. Because we are created in the image of God. Jesus did this word kenosis. He poured out his life on behalf of humanity because he was like God. And we were created to also pour out our lives. But the question is, what is worth pouring your life out for? Because it's not everything and everybody. So we're going to explore more about that. And to do this, I want to read a book. So we're getting two children's books today. This book is called The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein. Has anyone ever heard of the Giving Tree? It was read to me all the time. I think it was grade one. It was either grade one or grade two. My teacher was a huge Shel Silverstein fan. So when Caroline was born, I received this book as a gift and I was so excited. And then as I read it to her, it kind of gave me the icks, and we'll talk about why. This is not kenosis in this book. Okay, The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein. Once there was a tree, and she loved a little boy. And every day the boy would come, and he would gather her leaves and make them into crowns and play king of the forest. He would climb up her trunk and swing from her branches and eat apples, and they would play hide and go seek. And when he was tired, he would sleep in her shade. And the boy loved the tree very much. And the tree was happy. But time went by, and the boy grew older. And the tree was often alone. Then one day, the boy came to the tree, and the tree said, "Come, boy, come and climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and eat apples and play in my shade and be happy." "I am too big to climb and play," said the boy. "I want to buy things and have fun. I want some money. Can you give me some money?" "I'm sorry," said the tree, "but I have no money. I have only leaves and apples. Take my apples, buy and sell them in the city. Then you will have money and you will be happy." And so the boy climbed up the tree and gathered her apples and carried them away. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and the tree was sad. And then one day the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy and said, "Come, boy, climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and be happy." "I am too busy to climb trees," said the boy. "I want a house to keep me warm," he said. "I want a wife and I want children, and so I need a house. Can you give me a house?" "I have no house," said the tree. "The forest is my house, but you may cut off my branches and build a house, then you will be happy." And so the boy cut off her branches and carried them away to build his house. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and when he came back, the tree was so happy she could hardly speak. "Come, boy," she whispered, "come and play." "I am too old and sad to play," said the boy. "I want a boat that will take me away, that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat?" "Cut down my trunk and make a boat," said the tree. "Then you can sail away and be happy." And so the boy cut down her trunk and made a boat and sailed away. And the tree was happy, but not really. And after a long time, the boy came back again. "I'm sorry, boy," said the tree, "but I have nothing left to give you." "My apples are gone. My teeth are too weak for apples," said the boy. "My branches are gone," said the tree. "You cannot swing on them." "I am too old to swing on branches," said the boy. "My trunk is gone," said the tree. "You cannot climb." "I am too tired to climb," said the boy. "I'm sorry," sighed the tree. "I wish that I could give you something, but I have nothing left. I'm just an old stump. I am sorry." "I don't need very much now," said the boy. "Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I am very tired." "Well," said the tree, straightening herself up as much as she could, "well, an old stump is good for sitting and resting. Come, boy, sit down and rest." And the boy did. And the tree was happy. The end. So when we think of like generosity and selfless giving, sometimes we think of giving all of ourselves away to the diminishment of ourselves. In that story, the tree had nothing left because she gave away her essential self. She gave away like her integrity, her wholeness, and that she kept giving and giving. So this is not an example of kenosis. This is not an example of what Christ did by pouring his life out. And this is not what we are called to do. I came across something really interesting. Brené Brown was doing some research. I heard this in a podcast with Russell Brand a few years ago. And she was talking about how people who have the most compassion And she had worked with philanthropists, humanitarians, CEOs, teachers, doctors. She'd worked with a wide spectrum of people. And the one thing that the people who had the most compassion had in common was, I'll let you guess within yourselves. It was steel boundaries of steel for themselves. So the people who were able to pour out their lives the most, the people who were able to give the most, the people who had the most compassion were the ones with boundaries. And if we think about this in relation to the story where the tree gave everything away to the diminishment of the tree and had nothing left to give, boundaries are actually something that allow us to keep giving and to give and give and give. Boundaries, I think we get kind of confused about boundaries, where we think about boundaries as like, we're against something and we're resisting something and we're not gonna stand for something, so we're gonna put up our boundaries. But boundaries are an act of compassion. Boundaries are an act of unconditional love and unconditional care, because God created us for wholeness. God created us for peace. This word wholeness, integrity, peace, shalom, this is when we can keep our whole selves intact, like the tree, being able to keep the tree's whole self intact and give the gift of apples without giving the tree's self away. And in the same way, what boundaries are not a resistance against, but they are love and unconditional compassion for our own wholeness and our own integrity. And one of the ways we know that it's not kenosis, that we're pouring our lives out on something that we were never meant to pour our lives out on. Maybe we are an apple tree trying to like give roses, and that wasn't what we were created to offer the world. One of the ways that our bodies tell us that we are not in this kenosis, in this self-emptying that is bringing us closer to our essential self and closer to God and closer to each other, is we get resentful. So our bodies give us a clue like this isn't working when we start to get resentful. So the next time you are trying to be generous and giving, the next time somebody asks something of you and it feels there's something off about it, like you're doing it because you should, or you're doing it because you don't want to disappoint them, or you're doing it to be kind, I want you to tap into this unconditional love for yourself and not judge yourself for this resentment. It's just your body saying, this is a different thing. There's another way you need to go with this. And in our scripture today, Jesus was with Jesus who did this kenosis, this self-emptying, this pouring of his life on behalf of humanity. Jesus is with the religious leaders. And what happens with the religious leaders? They ask him a question. And Jesus is not beholden to answer their question. So you can pour your life out and still have boundaries. Jesus put up a boundary. And Jesus said, I'll answer your question if you answer my question. And he did not give them what they were looking for. And he didn't answer it. So what kenosis does, he didn't answer the question in the way they wanted him to answer the question. He did answer it. So what kenosis does is it allows us to give and pour out and be our most compassionate self while also keeping our wholeness and our integrity intact. So when we're giving, it's important to pay attention to what is diminishing us, what is making us weary, tired, fatigued, and what is, even though it's hard and even though we're sacrificing, what is pouring life back into us? This word kenosis, this pouring out, I don't know if you remember last week, we were talking about the body on freedom and how our bodies were meant to feel free. And we were talking about places we feel freedom and how that is one of the ways that the Spirit speaks to our bodies. And this word freedom that we learned last week from Hebrew, dorer, from Isaiah 61:1, the Isaiah text of the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because he has called me to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim liberty for the captives. This word liberty also means pouring out. We learned that last week, that there's this pouring out this freedom, this expansiveness that happens when we are in kenosis, when we are giving and pouring our life out in ways that we were called to pour out our life. So what I want you to do is remember Jesus. Jesus did not pour out his life for our sake because people demanded it of him. Jesus did not pour out his life because he was trying to be liked or because he was trying to be kind or because an institution forced him to pour out his life. Jesus poured out his life because he was God and because that is what God does. God pours out God's own life for us. And we will know that we are in kenosis. We are in this divine pouring out that we were called to do when we can stay in our wholeness, our peace, our integrity. And when the act of pouring out, as hard as it might be, as much sacrifice as it might involve, sets us free. Praise be to God for our bodies that, as we recently learned, process 11 million bits of information per minute, whereas our brains only process 40. Thanks be to God for giving us these amazing bodies so that we can know God more, know ourselves more, and know one another more, and that we may love each other more fully. Amen. Let us sing hymn number 574, Come Let Us Sing of a Wonderful Love, verses 1 and 2. Thank you, Michael.
I hope you're singing.
I am singing. Not singing lovely, because I don't have that capability, but definitely with joy. And now we come to the prayer of confession. We are always invited to receive God's grace in every moment of our life. And we have that opportunity if we're feeling heavy or if we're carrying any judgment or shame for ourselves or anyone else to let that go. God of justice, God of compassion, God of sacred and scandalous ways, we have so much still to learn. By your grace, we have come to know love more deeply than once before. Its mess, its complexity, its stubborn and tender truths transform us more each day. Through fires that refine and valleys of death, you have guided us. You draw us into the heart of wisdom, saving us from the lies of destruction, turning us towards hope that liberates. But still, O God, we struggle to trust in you. We confess we still shame Jesus when he turns over tables and rocks the boat. Search our hearts, O God, and see if there is any fearful complicity within us. Meet us there with your good news that sets the captives free. Forgive us from the harm we have done as we seek to harm no more. I invite you to offer your silent prayers. Amen. Beloveds, beloved body, beloved soul, God does not abandon us to the systems that destroy. God does not bind us to our regrets or forever hold us to what we once believed. God says, come and follow, know forgiveness and sin no more. Love abounds and justice shall be manifest. Wherever new life is desired, may the peace of Christ be welcomed among us. Thanks be to God who leads us on paths of resurrection. And now, John Webster, our board chair, will say some words.
Thank you, Katherine, and good morning. This is the time in our service where we present our offerings. We give some of the gifts that God has given to us so that the gifts may be given to others. We're truly blessed here at St. Andrew's United Church. With the help of the volunteers and special donations, we've made it through the summer months where traditionally our attendance drops off and our offerings are lower. The board has reworked our budget and cut expenses without cutting the services that St. Andrew's offers to the community and to the congregation. And from a financial standpoint, we are about where we expected to be. With the fall comes a challenge. Traditionally, this is a time when our congregation returns and revisits their pledges and commitments. It is important that, if you are able, the offerings resume to the usual level towards the end of the year. Thank you to all who are able to volunteer at St. Andrew's United Church by communicating and sharing with others in the congregation, by sharing the resources through their offering, by maintaining or increasing their PAR donation, by mailing in or dropping off their donation to the secure mailbox at the front door of the church, or electronically through their bank by clicking on the Donate Now button on the website. And thank you to those who are reaching out to support the members who are struggling. It's your gifts of time, talent, and money that we are truly thankful for. Together, we are building a different but stronger bond here at St. Andrew's United Church. And now please join Michael in singing hymn 540, Grant Us God the Grace of Giving.
Faithful One, your grace carries us through the unimaginable. When we fear we cannot bear the destruction that surrounds, you sustain our spirits. When we struggle to perceive the way to justice and healing, you speak through prophets ancient and new. For all the way life persists in the midst of COVID, in the midst of everything that would deaden, we bring our gifts with thanks. Amen. And now we have the prayers of the people. For this prayer, we're going to do an adapted metta meditation. And I invite you, when we start, to close your eyes and to think of somebody who just brings you absolute joy and delight. And as you're thinking about that, I want you to place your hand over your heart and to say, God, may this person have peace, wholeness, delight, and joy. And now I want you to think of a person who maybe you don't pay very much attention to, maybe the person who puts your groceries in your car, or maybe somebody who does the crosswalk at school, and I want you to send them this prayer. God, may this person experience your peace, your wholeness, your joy, and your delight. Now I ask that you would pray for all of the teachers who are going back to school. God, may our teachers experience your peace and your wholeness and your joy and your delight. Now I ask you to hold in your heart all of the frontline workers. and send them this prayer. God, may the frontline workers experience your peace and your wholeness, your joy and your delight. And now I ask that you call into your mind all of the churches in our church and pray for our church, saying, God, may all of the churches in our church experience your peace, your wholeness, your joy, and your delight. And now I ask that you would hold in your heart someone you know who is suffering with sickness in body, and pray for them. God, may all those suffering in body experience your peace and your wholeness and your joy and your delight. And now I ask that you would think about people who are going through a season of grief right now. God, may those who are going through grief experience your peace, your wholeness, your joy, and your delight. Now I ask that you think of the earth, the world, maybe a globe, and say this prayer for the whole earth. God, may all humanity experience peace and wholeness, joy and delight. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, may it be so. Amen. And now let us join Michael in singing hymn number 421, Lead On, O Cloud of Presence, verses 1 and 3. It is right, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, don't be sorry.
Oh.
Thank you, Michael. When you were singing, I sound so much better over here. two quick announcements. One, we are so thrilled to have Michelle Thomas join the team of St. Andrew's under the leadership of Lisa Bruce. A huge thank you to that. If you have not filled out the survey already, please do so. And she is going to share the gift of preaching with our congregation on October 25th as well. So thank you, Michelle. And then the second announcement is we are going to have coffee time after church. So we're going to leave the Zoom open starting today for people to chat. If there's too many people on the screen, we have the ability to break into like smaller rooms. So you are more than welcome after the prelude to stay and talk to your neighbor. And now, as the whole earth groans for freedom, we will find our way through practices of love. Love that is generous, love that is bold, love that is reciprocal and risky, love that does not abandon nor neglect, but is fulfilled in the joy of giving and receiving. Seeking liberation for all, let us go and live with faith. Thank you, Michael. I would love a postlude. You could even do the prelude again.
Next week.
All right, fair enough. So welcome everybody to coffee time. If you would like to stay and chat, you are more than welcome. Thank you for worshiping today.